So I'd now like to introduce our speakers. Dave Peterson is a senior research biologist with the U.S. Forest Service Pacific Northwest Research Station. He has conducted research on fire science and climate change throughout Western North America, has published over 220 scientific articles and 3 books, and is a contributing author for the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change and the U.S. National Climate Assessment. Dave recently published the book, Climate Change and United States Forest, and currently works on climate change adaptation on federal lands throughout the West. Jessica Halofsky is a research ecologist with the University of Washington and is affiliated with the U.S. Forest Service Pacific Northwest Research Station. Her research interests include climate change, fire and disturbance ecology, and vegetation dynamics. Jessica has led several climate change adaptation partnerships on federal lands throughout the West and is working on a new book about the effects of climate change in the Rocky Mountains. Welcome, Dave and Jessica.
Well, thank you very much for that introduction, and we appreciate everyone spending some time with us today. We especially appreciate the invitation to be part of this particular webinar series. We always enjoy working with the Great Northern LCC as well as the other LCCs in the West. Each of the 4 LCCs that exist in the areas of our adaptation partnerships have been partners, have participated in workshops, and in some cases contributed funding. So we really appreciate that participation and that input to the process, and we hope that the work that we're doing also falls under the mission of the LCCs. We hope that relationship lasts for a long time. Today we'd like to go over some things that we've been working on for the last several years relative to climate change adaptation in the Western U.S. This has mostly been on federal lands, and some of you have probably heard some of this before. And today we're going to focus on how we take this rather slippery issue and move it from conceptual use to actual practice on the ground. So I always like to start out with a bit of a definition on climate change adaptation, just to make sure we're all on the same page. Some of you may have seen this Gary Larson cartoon. I think a lot of our resource managers feel like this in general, but they also feel about they kind of feel like this with respect to climate change adaptation. You have to make a choice. You have to do something, and it may not turn out exactly right, and somebody may not be happy with you, but you still have to move forward with decision making. So in our work, we define adaptation as an effort to reduce the potentially negative outcomes of climate change and transition systems to a new situation or new set of conditions in a warmer climate. Most people focus just on that first one, but in many cases, some negative consequences may be inevitable, so we have to find ways to transition those systems. Mostly, this is about fine-tuning and prioritizing existing practices. I think initially a lot of resource leadership thinks this is going to change their world. It's going to completely revise resource management, and that is not the case at all. We're all already doing lots of good things out on the landscape in the name of sustainable management, so we need to continue those and perhaps adjust what we're doing now to make them a little bit more climate smart. Basically, this is a form of risk management, and resource managers do risk management all the time, whether it's fire or flooding or infrastructure or, you know, other kinds of things. And just a little add-on here, given that I work for the Forest Service, a lot of our work has been on Forest Service lands, the recently issued planning rule requires it now. So it's no longer an option to include climate change and adaptation in your plans, but it is required. There's a lot of information that's already in existence about this topic. In 2011, we published this guidebook is what we're calling it for responding to climate change. And although it's focused on national forests, I do think it's applicable to almost any public lands. We have been using a consistent process that was described in that particular publication throughout our work. This process always starts with the science management partnership. So this simply refers to a group of research scientists, resource specialists in federal agencies and other organizations who make a commitment for a year or two to work together, to talk to each other, and eventually produce an assessment and adaptation plan. This will start typically with an education phase that can consist of face-to-face connections at workshops. It can include webinars. That is followed by the vulnerability assessment, which is the bulk of the work. This is primarily a scientific endeavor, and it's mostly a synthesis of existing information, although we often do new analyses as well. The assessment is used as a foundation to develop adaptation options. That's primarily the purview of resource managers who actually have experience working on different pieces of ground and can best develop options in response to different scenarios. And then finally, the implementation phase is taking all of this information and actually incorporating it in how we go about doing business, whether it's in a resource management plan, a project plan, a NEPA document, or whatever. And just as a preview, this is the step that we've stumbled on a bit. I think we're much better at steps 1, 2, and 3. 4 is still a new thing for most federal agencies, and they're just now starting to do a good job on it. As I mentioned, there's a lot of information already out there. You know, we have 30-some years of climate change science. The Forest Service has this portal called the Climate Change Resource Center that's been up and running now for about 6 years. It's just got a ton of information in forms that are accessible to resource managers. So it's science made accessible, basically. Invite you to take a look at that sometime if you haven't already. A couple years ago, we published this synthesis of effects of climate change on forest ecosystems as part of the National Climate Assessment. There are about 1,000 references in that one. We published this book in 2014. Same thing, lots of information out there. And then recently, we developed what's called the Climate Change Adaptation Library. This is a synopsis of all the different adaptation strategies and adaptation tactics relative to vegetation, water, fisheries, etc., that we've compiled over the last several years. And so there are 100-some different adaptation strategies and over 400 different research tactics that we already have here. So we hope that people will use this in the future and they won't have to keep reinventing the wheel. But basically, it's a way of sharing the information that we've already compiled that will maybe save others some time. And so I love this graphic because most of the resource managers I know tell me that when it comes to scientific information, they feel like they're drinking from a fire hose, that there's so much out there. I mean, I know I can't keep up with it. Well, how can we expect our resource managers to keep up with all the current science? And my personal opinion is we don't really need more research to go about adaptation. We have more than enough to get started. Yes, there will always be some areas of uncertainty that we would like to address, but that's true for almost everything we do. So my feeling is that we need to really get this moving as quickly as we can. So asking the big general question, how do we manage for resiliency in a warmer climate? This is kind of the big issue. It's relevant to climate change. It's also relevant to restoration activities, which are very common on most of our federal lands across the West. So you can kind of kill two birds with one stone here. The main thing, the most important thing that we will have to deal with in the future are the effects of extreme weather and increased disturbance. So parts of the West this last year had a significant drought, I think people's attention for sure. And so we anticipate that these extreme droughts, high temperatures, increased fire, and so forth will become a lot more common in the future. These are the things that change ecosystems quickly. So to me, it makes most sense to focus on these disturbances in the future. And I just want to put out a few very general adaptation strategies that seem to always come through when we're working with national forests and national parks around the West. The first one is this idea of increasing landscape diversity, and this focuses on large spatial scales. We hear a lot about biodiversity in general, but in this case, we're talking about a diversification of patterns, structures, ages, those sorts of things across thousands to millions of acres. Examples would be, continue to implement thinning and fuel treatments and so forth, and do this in a strategic manner so that we have different blocks of size and age classes across the landscape. Then if you do have an insect outbreak or big fire, you hopefully won't lose the whole thing. So this is just the concept of trying to hedge your bets a little bit by diversifying. The second one, and this may seem odd, is treating these large disturbances as an opportunity. Most commonly, both in science and in the media, we hear about big fires as being catastrophes. But trying to look on the bright side of things, there are also opportunities to put new management strategies on the ground. And so you're starting over, and you have an opportunity to change things across large landscapes. That can include some experimentation with different kinds of techniques. The key here is to develop plans for addressing these large disturbances before they occur. As we all know, in most cases, it's not a situation of if something will occur, but when it will occur, especially a large fire. So get those plans completed, get them approved, so you can hit the ground running and won't have to go through endless appeals and litigation following that disturbance. The third thing is to formally incorporate risk assessment as a structural tool for planning and management. So you can either quantify or maybe just estimate the risk that climate change will cause for different resources across any particular landscape. In this case, I use sort of the IPCC model of magnitude of consequences versus likelihood of impact. Very simple matrix here, 3x3. So we can identify where we are currently and then track that through time as climate change continues to impact things. It's going here from the yellow zone up to the red zone. So we can use this sort of simple risk assessment to guide our adaptation responses. If we're down in the yellow zone, we can just pretty much monitor things. But once we get up into the orange zone, we need some better evaluation, start developing strategies, and then we need to, get those strategies developed and on the ground if we get into kind of the high danger zone of things. So this is a simple thing that can be used for any kind of resource, vegetation, water, fisheries, and so forth. Just a conceptual tool.
So I'm going to give some highlights from the vulnerability assessments and workshops we've conducted in the West and review some of the key outcomes. As Dave showed in the previous slide, part of our process is to conduct hands-on science manager workshops. And in those workshops, we have the resource managers identify key vulnerabilities, and then associated with those vulnerabilities, identify adaptation strategies, which are general strategies to address the vulnerabilities, and then on the ground, adaptation tactics. So I'm going to give a couple of examples of those, and I'm going to start with water and infrastructure here. So when thinking about infrastructure, managers identified higher winter peak stream flows as an important consideration, mainly because these higher flows have the potential to cause more infrastructure damage. And so the general strategy they devised to address that sensitivity was to, in general, increase the resilience of roads and infrastructure to higher winter peak flows by designing the infrastructure to accommodate those higher peak flows. And so specific adaptation tactics associated with that strategy included installing larger culverts, in some cases moving roads out of floodplains, and maybe relocating campgrounds that are subject to continual flooding and damage over time. Okay, moving on to an example from fisheries. Increased stream temperatures will be a major stressor for cold water adapted fish species in a warmer climate. And so a general strategy to address warmer stream temperatures is to restore and maintain cold water habitat wherever possible. To start, it's important to know where that existing cold water habitat is located. So there is a need for baseline information and to map that cold water habitat. Other tactics include increasing off-channel habitat and protecting refugia and side channels, also ensuring that passage for aquatic organisms are effective. And in addition, riparian function and hydrological processes can be maintained by restoring riparian vegetation to ensure that exposure to stream channels to solar radiation is minimized. Moving on to vegetation. For vegetation, there's always been a big focus on fire and insects as agents of change with warming climate. And we know that with warming climate, there will be increased area burned by wildfire and that the fire season will be longer. So a general strategy is to increase ecosystem resilience to more frequent fire. Dave has talked about this a little bit. Adaptation tactics are often focused on decreasing forest density to increase drought resilience and decrease the severity of fire and insect attacks. And as Dave mentioned, we also want to manage forests for a diversity of stand ages, structures, and species. And that's the idea of not putting all of our eggs in one basket and trying to avoid broad-scale high mortality events. So my last examples are from recreation. To our knowledge, these recreation vulnerability assessments are relatively new. We covered a lot of different types of recreation in one of our recent assessments in the Northern Rockies. So I'm going to give an example from summer recreation and then one from winter recreation. And overall, the demand for warm weather activities is expected to increase due to a direct effect of climate change on season length. Warmer temperatures are expected to result in earlier availability of snow and ice-free sites, and also an increase in the number of warm weather days in spring and autumn. So the challenge will be to ensure that recreation opportunities exist in the future under these changing conditions. And a first step is to try to understand how use patterns are changing, particularly in those shoulder seasons. And then the capacity of recreation sites can be adjusted accordingly. We also may see more frequent failures in the road and trail systems, which could increase risk to public safety. And so in response, managers might have to implement and enforce more restrictions on access to areas where trails and roads are damaged and safe access is uncertain. And my final example is from winter recreation. And this is what the Cascades in Northern Rockies looked like last year. And some ski resorts were open for a very short season. And ski resorts are going to see significant negative impacts of warming temperatures, which will result in less snow and often wetter or icier snow. And in some cases, the winter recreation infrastructure may not be where the snow still is. So a general strategy is to increase management flexibility of these recreation sites. Specifically, we may want to expand facilities in area where there's still snow and where concentrated use increases. And we may also want to develop some other options for snow-based recreation, such as additional ski lifts, maybe even things like helicopter skiing and toboggan runs. So we've completed a number of different projects across the western U.S. This shows a map of where these projects have been. Our completed and in-progress projects encompass 40 national forests and 7 national parks. We've completed projects on the Olympic, in the North Cascadia region, the Blue Mountains, and also in the Northern Rockies. And we're currently working in Southwest Washington, South Central Oregon, and the Intermountain region of the Forest Service. As Dave mentioned, LCCs have been a big partner in all of our projects, and we've covered national forests in a number of the different LCC areas. We're excited to start in the Intermountain region and cover some of the Great Basin and Southern Rocky LCC areas. Now, typically, we always allow resource managers to choose what resource areas they want to cover in the assessments. Typically, we cover vegetation and disturbance, wildlife, water, and fish. As I mentioned, more recently, we've gotten into topics including recreation, infrastructure, ecosystem services, and also cultural resources. In general, the outcomes of our process include increasing climate change thinking and awareness overall. It helps to form climate change partnerships that last beyond the length of the initial project. It involves a lot of data gathering and information sharing among different partners in the project region. We have a website, adaptationpartners.org, and there is a page for each of the projects. And this is something that different partners and team members involved can point to as the project progresses. We always put updates on where the projects are on the various websites. And as a product from each of these partnerships, we do a peer-reviewed U.S. Forest Service General Technical Report. And this can serve as a reference for resource managers, which includes climate change projections and impacts on the different resource areas. And it also gives them a menu of adaptation options that they can consider moving forward to incorporate climate change in their management. And as scientists, we like to get some journal articles out of the process. And then there are also a number of follow-up projects in the various regions. And we've seen several follow-up projects for work on the North Cascades and Olympics. This is an example of one of the general technical reports that we published as a result of the process. This one is for the North Cascades region. We think one of the most important outcomes of our process is building organizational capacity. You know, it's a big challenge for federal agencies in embracing climate change to build the capacity to address a pretty complex issue. But we think our process helps them to begin to do that. We're also working with land managers on the implementation step. As Dave said, this has been one of the most challenging and is kind of the newer part of the process for us and for others. And so we're working with resource managers to help them incorporate these assessments into planning, strategies, NEPA analysis, and also monitoring. And we've seen a number of revised management approaches on the ground as a result of these partnerships. For example, Olympic National Forest has modified its stand density management guidelines in light of a warmer climate. We've seen several national forests in the Pacific Northwest modify their engineering guidelines for roads and culverts in anticipation of higher peak flows in the winter. And national forests and parks throughout the West are modifying conservation strategies for cold water fish, especially bull trout, which will experience stress from lower summer stream flows and higher temperatures. And we're also seeing that the assessment and adaptation information is being integrated in national forest plan revisions, which are currently accelerating across the West. We have learned some lessons along the way about making partnerships work. We found that it's really important to engage leadership in the process and get their buy-in. In the National Forest System, there's a system of climate change coordinators at the regional level and then at the National Forest level. And so it's also important to get their involvement. And they serve as a kind of network to distribute information. It's really important to develop a sense of commitment and trust. And these partnerships are relationships, and like all relationships, they require trust. They take time and energy. They require very good communication. and also a realistic schedule. You know, everybody's busy, and this isn't anybody, very few people can focus on this as their only task, and so it's really important to make sure that the schedule works for everybody. And for that same reason, it's important to choose battles wisely. And of course, work with partners and share experiences that everybody has. And just in general, put a focus on sustainable resource management. Climate change as one of many stressors and topics and things that the resource managers have to deal with. As we've mentioned a couple of times, we do have a website, adaptationpartners.org. There's information on each of the projects and also the Climate Change Adaptation Library, which has the menu of climate change adaptation strategies and tactics that Dave mentioned. And with that, we'd be happy to take questions.
Great. Thanks, Jessica and Dave. So note to the audience, we're open for questions. So if you have a question or comment, please submit it by typing in the questions pane, which should be on the right side of your screen. I'll then read it to Jessica and Dave, and they can respond. Or if you'd like, you can raise your hand. There's an icon that you can raise next to your name on the attendee list, and I will unmute you to ask a question via phone or computer mic. So, Dave and Jessica, we don't have any questions right now. Just wait. Hopefully people can give them a minute or so to type their thoughts in. Any other key, you know, one thing I was thinking, you guys offered a lot of resources during this webinar. That's something that I could include, I'd like to include on the webinar event page, and that I can send out to folks in the future or next week when I send out the recording. So perhaps we can include those resources so everybody will have them at their fingertips.
Yeah, I'd also like to mention that the Adaptation Partners website has a list of all of our publications related to adaptation, and I think there are links to most of those. So that's another easy place to find things.
Yeah, that's great, Dave. That's a great resource. We do have a couple questions coming in, so I'd like to read them at this time. The first question is from Shannon. Are there any projects close to the monitoring phase? If so, what are examples?
I can make a start on that, and then Jessica, if you have anything to follow up on, you can. So as part of our adaptation partnership in the Northern Rockies, Lynn Huang, who's a climate change coordinator there, has wanted to ensure from the very start that the information developed in the assessment and adaptation work could feed directly into guiding future monitoring. So now that that assessment is pretty much done, that should be able to move forward. And I think I saw Lynn's name on the attendee list here today, so maybe she can offer some more detail. I think in most national forests and national parks in the West, this process of informing monitoring is just starting. And, you know, one thing that people always ask about is, what are the indicators we should use? You know, what are the things to look at? These assessments are good. Also, this within the last month, there was a publication that was issued by the Northern Research Station of the Forest Service. It's a general technical report that focuses specifically on indicators for climate change. And that's part of the Global Change Research Program's broader effort across all different resources. So if people are really keen on that topic, you could take a look at that publication.
Thanks, Dave. There's a question from Kurt. When do you expect to publish the Region 1 climate change paper?
I can answer that. Kurt, we currently have draft, almost final version of the chapters in the report. We're still waiting on a few. Then it has to go through the Rocky Mountain Research Station publication process. But once we have a full draft that we can call impress, we'll put it up on the Adaptation Partners website under the Northern Rockies Project.
You know, that makes me think, can people subscribe to the any kind of news feed that you guys have so they can be made aware of these type of publications and other events and resources as they become available?
Yes, there are listservs for both the Northern Rockies and Intermountain projects that you can join by.
Well, all of our recent...
Jessica or Dave, do you want to... somebody get cut off there?
Oh, sorry. I'm not sure if you heard. There, you can join the listserv for both the Northern Rockies and Intermountain projects via the Adaptation Partners website.
No, that's okay. And anybody who has...
Dave, you're cutting out for some reason, so perhaps maybe you want to check your phone.
And anybody who has specific issues they'd like to discuss...
Hey, Dave, for some reason I hear you cut out, so I'm just going to go on to the next question and maybe...
Okay, how does this sound?
Okay, now you sound good. Go ahead. Jessica, is he cutting out for you too?
He is, yeah.
Okay. I'm just going to go on to the next question while he maybe thinks with his phone a little bit. Here's a question from Peter. Dave mentioned the role of adaptation in the 2012 planning rule, and Jessica mentioned adaptation strategies being integrated into plan revisions. Can you guys talk a bit more about how the adaptation work is being incorporated into forest plan revisions?
Yeah, well, that process is just starting. Oh, Dave, did you want to answer that?
Well, can you guys hear me okay?
Yes, now we can.
Okay, very good. So, as Jessica just said that part is just starting. I will say, as a caveat here, that there is not explicit guidance for exactly how to do this process. Based on the 2012 planning rule. The current guidance available for the Forest Service is based on 2010 guidance before the planning rule was issued. So each of the regions in the Forest Service are treating this a little bit individually in terms of what kinds of information is considered to be necessary and sufficient. I don't think there are any good examples to date of how this has been done. So we're sort of standing at the ready here to assist different regions and national forests with doing this sort of thing. I think it will end up being, you know, just another component of forest planning by resource area. So under the water section of a forest plan, you would have something for water if it's relevant. Under the wildlife section, you have something there if it's relevant. So each of the National Forest will have to make a judgment call on whether or not they think there's sufficient evidence from the assessments that we've developed to justify including that. So we hope that this process of implementation will really accelerate over the next couple of years. We've had some really good initial feedback and good conversations about this, and so I hope in a year or two we have some good examples.
Thanks, Dave. Now a question from Gretchen. Can you give an example using the magnitude of consequences and likelihood of impact table?
Well, sure. I guess I would give an example with my favorite topic of fire. So if we look at, let's say, the a number of acres burned per year as an indicator of a climate change effect. If we're looking at forests that are in the interior west, our dry forests, there will probably be both a high likelihood that that will occur, and the magnitude of consequences will also be high because of the broad effect on resources. If we were to take that same example and look on the west side of the Cascades, we would probably have a moderate likelihood of increased area burned, but the consequences would be relatively small because it wouldn't burn enough area often enough to really influence ecosystem structure and function or economic values. So that's a case where we take the same topic in different locations and the risk assessment is really quite different. I hope that gets at it. That gets at the question.
Thanks, Dave. Natalie Little wanted to let Dave and Jessica know. First of all, Natalie's the Region 4 Climate Change Coordinator, and she asked Dave and Jessica to extend an invitation to the group to attend a two-day Intermountain workshop in May, June, and that there will be 5 workshops throughout the region.
Yes, and there will also be some webinars for the Intermountain project that you can all tune into as well.
And again, they can find that information on the website, is that correct?
Yes, yes. And that's for the Intermountain Adaptation Partnership.
Correct, thanks. Now we have a question from Shannon. Do any of the assessments include looking at human communities or livelihoods dependent on public lands?
Yes, our recreation and ecosystem services teams have been thinking more and more about that. The Northern Rockies assessment and the ecosystem services chapter does have some of that information and thinks about community vulnerability to climate change. And I believe our Intermountain Partnership ecosystem services chapter will as well a little bit. But it is a relatively new topic for our assessments.
And we alluded to this in the webinar, but some of the more traditional topics were the ones that we started out on, but there's more and more demand for looking at an assessment of climate change effects on, you know, social and economic factors. And the Forest Service requires now that ecosystem services be considered in assessments. So this is becoming more common. We don't have as much expertise on some of these topics as we do on the others. A kind of special note, too, about resource-dependent communities, especially those associated with ski areas. We are doing some specific work in our Intermountain Adaptation Partnership with areas that we think might be affected by lower snowpack in the future that would also directly affect local economies. Same thing in South Central Oregon. So we'll try to get better at this over time as we learn more about it, and we'll try to develop some new analyses. At the moment, there is not a lot of scientific literature that can be directly applied to specific landscapes. So we will have to do some original research and investigation here. And if anybody on the webinar today is particularly interested in that topic or has expertise, we'd love to hear your feedback on these issues.
Dave. Daniel just wanted to provide a resource as an excellent resource and listserv that he mentioned CAKE, the Climate Adaptation Knowledge Exchange. Which I'm sure could be easily found by Googling that. Now we have a question from Kurt. He's asking, is your definition of climate change appropriate for use in plan revision documents?
I'm not totally sure about the question, but usually in plan guidance, and I know the current guidance that's available at least for the Forest Service on climate change does define what they're talking about. In our assessments and our uses of the term climate change, we also like to include the word or the term climate variability, because that is what people mostly deal with. I mean, we don't really know when any particular, fire or insect outbreak or whatever is caused by climate change. So we kind of like to use a broader brush to include variability in that. But I do think when new guidance does come out about that, and for a forest plan revision, it will be clearly defined, probably in something arcane like the Forest Service Handbook. Be my guess. I'm not sure if I answered the question adequately, though.
That's okay. He can respond if he wants to raise his hand. I can unmute him, or he could send another message.
Question? Okay.
Clarify. That sounds good. So we have a question from Andrew. He's part of the Gunnison Climate Working Group, and they have socioeconomics in their work. Corey Knapp, PhD with Western State Colorado University, did that as well as Katie Clifford at CU. So that was in response to the socioeconomic work or question I think that was asked previously.
Well, we love to hear that, and if you could, you know, send me a quick email with any references or links, that would be great. We do hope to develop a partnership in the near future with the Rocky Mountain region of the Forest Service that would include the Gunnison area.
And just a quick note from Shannon, who asked a couple questions. She said Corey and herself are also doing a social vulnerability assessment for Colorado BLM. Just a note. And our next question is from Kurt again. He was asking if he could use your definition in plan revision docs. He's the one who asked about the definition and said, can he use your definition in plan revision documents?
Well, of course.
Love that.
I don't see why not. I think as long as you have a definition, that's the key. Sometimes people use words like climate change or resilience or restoration without defining what they mean. So as long as he's happy with it and the organization is happy with it, and of course it helps to cite something as well.
Right. And a question from Carolyn. What do you think is the best route to get to the adaptation stage? Vulnerability assessments, collections of local environmental information, or something else?
Well, probably a combination of both, but we do think that vulnerability assessments are a key step in the process and provide the basis, a stepping off point for the development of adaptation strategies and tactics. Sometimes, you know, people think they can skip that step, but sometimes surprising things come out of vulnerability assessments. When you kind of dig down and try to apply information to a local area, it really helps you pinpoint the key sensitivities.
Yeah, I totally agree with Jessica's response on that. And, you know, a lot of the information, the examples that Jessica provided during the webinar, she was just basically recapitulating what we elicited at workshops with resource managers. So just think, take a scenario of what climate change might do or anything else, put it in front of a resource specialist, and then ask them how they would respond to reach their management goals. That's all this process is. It's a rather iterative, but I think a very robust process. The other caveat to this is that given the nature of the scientific information that we have on a lot of resources, the inferences will by necessity be rather coarse scale, large geographic scales. So it's not always going to be very easy to get down to a particular stream reach or a particular 10 acres of ground. And the local resource managers will always have to use their expert knowledge to do that kind of mental downscaling from the scientific information we have to the application on the ground. And that's a really cool process to watch at the workshops, because we have found that the resource managers do an excellent job of this and come up with some very creative outcomes. And also I've seen some other workshops that we've done with just local citizens and people involved in different business enterprises. And they too can think pretty darn clearly about these issues when they're presented with scenarios.
And it looks like we have one more question from Randy. What are examples of some key adaptations or management changes to help address riparian area vulnerability in aquatic species? What is a good reference for these?
So we have a couple references. One of the most recent that addressed riparian areas in particular was for our Blue Mountains work. And that draft assessment is available on the website under the Blue Mountain Adaptation Partnership for riparian areas and groundwater-dependent ecosystems in particular. But some examples that have come up for riparian areas, one is restoration, make sure the riparian areas are intact, remove invasive species, things like, you know, ensure proper hydrologic function, so make sure floodplains are intact, things like that. Any other examples, Dave?
Beavers,
oh yeah.
I think every partnership we've developed has come up with the reintroduction and maintenance of healthy beaver populations as one of the best things you can do to maintain water on the landscape and improve the resilience of riparian systems. Riparian and wetland systems is a discrete category that we have in the Adaptation Library, too, so there's quite a bit of information in there if you want to take a look at that. The cool thing about it is that responding in a climate-smart way is almost always compatible with existing restoration goals for riparian areas, so it's a real win-win situation.
Great, thanks you guys. Just one more comment. Lynn Hoing just joined the call a little while ago, and this is just in reference to Peter's questions, and she just said to Peter that she's currently working on the process to incorporate the NRAP work into planning, and that Peter's welcome to call her for more information about it.
Lynn's a great contact because she is both the regional climate change coordinator and the monitoring lead for the northern region of the Forest Service, so it's a great combination.
Great. Well, it looks like that's it. Those are all the questions we have in the queue, and no one's hands are raised, so I'm going to go ahead and wrap things up. Dave or Jessica, do you have anything that you'd like to add in closing?
I'd just like to thank everyone for their attention today, and feel free to get in touch with us if you have any questions or want to discuss.
Yeah, thank you very much for joining the webinar today, and don't hesitate to send us emails if you'd like to participate in existing partnerships or get something new going or just talk about things. Please get in touch.
Great. Well, thanks to both you, Dave and Jessica, for presenting today, and I'd also like to thank our audience for attending the webinar. And just a couple last-minute notes for those who came in late. I will be sending an email with the link to the webinar recording next week, so you'll get that. And then our next webinar is February 10th, and Mike Young with the U.S. Forest Service Rocky Mountain Research Station will be presenting on the use of environmental DNA sampling to inventory bull trout. More information can be found on the Great Northern website at greatnorthernlcc.org. So that concludes today's webinar. Goodbye, everyone, and enjoy your day.